2, the Knights Templar. Perhaps no other secret society is enjoying a greater resurgence in popularity currently than the Order of the Knights Templar. From Dan Brown's best-selling novel The Da Vinci Code to countless Hollywood blockbusters, numerous theories and speculation surrounds this pre-medieval phenomena, and it's easy to see why. With their colorful hybrid of valiant chivalry, unanswered mysteries, and unmitigated bravado, the historical Knights Templar cut a broad swath through the collective unconscious, at once evoking the gallantry of the Crusades, the exotic mystique of journeys into foreign lands, and pathos for their ultimate demise. Apologists for the Knights Templar portray them as misunderstood martyrs, whose self-sacrifice at the behest of imperial conquest forever altered the course of history. Hardly a bad reputation for an order that was disbanded and burned at the stake over 700 years ago. Yet the Templar mystique has continued to filter, oftentimes unseen, not only into popular lore but through the underground stream of secret societies. In this chapter, I hope to examine not only the history of the Order as well as their mysteries, but their influence in more shadowy undertakings as well. An influence that may indicate not only the undying love for the Templar mystique and the continuation of their ideals, but perhaps a continuation of their very existence itself. Origins of the Knights Templar, IZR. The poor fellow soldiers of Christ and of the Temple of Solomon, more commonly referred to as the Knights Templar, came about in 1120 at the urging of French knight Hugues de Payens, who had approached both the king and patriarch of Jerusalem to grant an official monastic order for the protection of pilgrims visiting the holy city of Jerusalem. At the time of their inception, the Templars only numbered 9 in their ranks, all of whom had sworn a specific vow of poverty. Just 30 years later, their numbers had swollen to the thousands and were prosperous enough to lend money and credit to both citizens and government figures alike. During the time of the Crusades, the Templars were often a key military component for the expansion of the Holy Roman Empire, being utilized as advanced shock troops in some of the most decisive battles of the conquest, including the Battle of Montchassard, where some 500 knights helped defeat the legendary Sultan Saladin's troops, which numbered over 26,000 combatants. Both their reputation as fearless and feckless warrior monks, as well as the uncouth lore surrounding them, a regular euphemism of the time was to drink and swear like a Templar, helped establish the reputation of the Knights Templar as one of the most elite and fearsome scourges to attack the Middle East, a reputation they shared with the Hashishans of the previous chapter, of whom the Templars undoubtedly came into contact with, and it is rumored, integrated certain philosophical tenets and mysteries into their secret initiation rites. By 1307, both the wealth, reputation, and arrogance of the Templars had fallen into negative favor, particularly with the newly elected Pope Clement V, who sought to merge the order with another Christian military council, the Order of the Hospitallers, granting him benefit and power over both, as well as King Philip IV of France, who was in debt to the Templars as a result of his war with England. Rumors began to abound about the Templars' secret teachings. They were reputed to regularly engage in homosexuality, both denying the divinity of Christ and both trampling and spitting on the cross as part of their initiation rites, and worshipping a strange, bearded, idol of a head, alternately, the head of a goat they referred to as Baphomet. These charges, along with others that constitute what was unquestionably heretical in 14th century France, have never been proven. But they have also never been disproven. Homosexuality Homosexuality has been a common practice among soldiers who, traveling long distances of many years without wives, seek some form of edification, and may have been more prevalent among warrior monks sworn to uphold a vow of celibacy. Denying and insulting the divinity of Jesus may seem like an unusual practice among sworn defenders of Christendom, but what better way to instill fear and test a potential recruit's bravado than attacking the general tenets of their sworn allegiance?